A very good afternoon to all the participants and our distinguished speaker. I am Meenal Jadhav, and on behalf of SETS-CRNTS IIT Bombay, I take this opportunity to welcome you all for today's talk on NMR spectroscopy titled Application of Paramagnetic Relaxation Enhancement, NMR-based method for probing structure and dynamics in biomolecules, which will be presented by Professor Rishita Sen Gupta. Before we start, I would like to give you a brief overview of SETS IIT Bombay. SETS IIT Bombay was inaugurated by our ex-Prime Minister Shri Morarji Desai in the year 1976. DST has set up SETS in various parts of the country with the objective of providing guidance for data acquisition using sophisticated analytical instruments. SETS was established at IIT Bombay in the year 1976 with the DST support. CRNT, also known as Center for Research in Nanotechnology and Sciences, was established at IIT Bombay in the year 2006. In the year 2008, both SETS and CRNTS were merged and came under one umbrella, which is led by one in charge. Currently, Professor Anil Kotantriyal is the head of the department. We have 16 major equipment under SETS and 5 major equipment under CRNTS. SETS provides measurement services to the researchers at IIT Bombay as well as to the users from various academic institutes, national laboratories and industries. CRNTS also have an academic wing in which we have more than 65 associated faculty members and more than 80 PhD students. In the financial year 2019-2020, we have got almost 2,700 users and we have analyzed more than 25,000 samples. The current slide shows the 16 instruments which are housed at SETS IIT Bombay, which are funded by the DST, of which NMR 600 is the topic of our talk today. We have upcoming dual beam FIB FEGSM, which is under installation. These are the five instruments which are housed at SETS IIT Bombay, which are funded by the institutes. This is NMR lab at SETS, and this is NMR 600 MHz spectrometer. Dr. Nutan Agadi is the in charge. This instrument is equipped with multinuclear solution state probe with variable temperature accessories and a solid state probe, multinuclear solid state probe. To get detailed information about SETS IIT Bombay, you can visit us at setsiitb.ac.in, wherein you can find the information about all the instruments housed at SETS IIT Bombay and also the procedures to avail these facilities. We get the samples from various parts of the country as well as from our neighboring country, Nepal. We encourage our users from various academic institutes, national laboratories and industries to visit our facility. We also have a YouTube channel where you can get the videos of our previous webinars. You can join us on LinkedIn, where you can get the information about the latest information about the instruments, webinars or any upcoming event held at SETS IIT Bombay. This is the brochure for ongoing webinar series, the information for which is listed on our SETS website as well as on our LinkedIn page. All the instruments at SETS IIT Bombay are managed and operated by our dedicated staff. We are very happy to help you with the analysis. Now I introduce to you our today's speaker, Professor Rishita Sen Gupta. Professor Rishita Sen Gupta is currently an assistant professor in the Department of Chemistry at IIT Bombay. She has completed her PhD from Ohio State University and has done her postdoc in National Center of Biological Sciences. They are mostly interested in studying protein structures and dynamics using biomolecular NMR spectroscopy. The laboratory will work at the intersection of physical chemistry and structural biology of proteins using a combination of NMR and other spectroscopic tools with the help of modern molecular biology and protein biochemistry techniques. Professor Rishita Sen Gupta has published and co-authored around 11 research papers in the international peer-reviewed journals. We assure that this talk will enlighten the knowledge of researchers to use NMR for their international peer-reviewed NMR for their research purpose. Before I take your leave, I would like to just an important note: queries related to today's talk should be posted in the question and answer box only. Question with the participant's name only will be answered. We will be posting the feedback form. Kindly fill it. It will help us to improvise. So let us commence today's talk. Over to you, Professor Rishita.
All right. Thank you very much for this opportunity to speak in the SETS webinar series. So I had earlier decided that I will only speak about paramagnetic relaxation enhancement based NMR methods, but I thought that I will also include other effects which we can see on NMR spectra when we introduce an unpaired electron. for example, spectral shifts and so on, so that this is more of a, more comprehensive review of what effects an unpaired electron can have on NMR spectrum. Okay, so I will start with a very simple introduction of what a paramagnetic species is. A paramagnetic species is anything which contains an unpaired electron. So it could be a nitroxide radical. It could be a paramagnetic metal ion like manganese 2+, copper 2+, Fe 2+, cobalt 2+, nickel 2+, lanthanides in their 3+ charge state, etc. All of these have unpaired electrons and hence they are paramagnetic. Inside of biomolecules, for example, proteins, either a paramagnetic metal ion may already be present naturally, for example, in paramagnetic metalloproteins, or we can introduce them artificially by replacing the diamagnetic metal, which is present within the metalloprotein, with a paramagnetic metal ion of our choice, provided that the structure is not perturbed significantly by the introduction of such a paramagnetic metal ion. And if we do not have a naturally occurring paramagnetic metalloprotein, then we can also artificially introduce a paramagnet by labeling with either a derivatized nitroxide spin label or with a metal binding tag. And I will discuss how to do this towards the end of my talk. Okay, so when we introduce an unpaired electron within a sample which is NMR active, what happens is that the nuclear spins and the unpaired electron actually interact with each other through different kinds of mechanisms. And the Hamiltonian, which basically describes this interaction, is this hyperfine interaction, hyperfine Hamiltonian, which is shown here. So if, for example, if S is our electron spin, an unpaired electron spin, and if I is our nuclear spin, and let's assume for once that they are fixed in space at their respective positions, R is the vector which basically joins the positions of the electron and the nucleus. Then, and theta is the angle between the external magnetic field B0 and this R. Then there is a dipolar as well as a scalar sort of an interaction which might take place between I and S. So basically the magnetic moments of the unpaired electron and the nucleus interact with each other. The magnetic moment is given by this equation, which is shown here. Mu s is equals to g mu b root over of s into s plus 1. S is the spin quantum number. So depending upon r and theta, the dipolar interaction will vary. And also, if suppose the electron and the nucleus are part of a larger molecule which can tumble, then too the interaction might be modulated by such a motion. Okay. And this sort of a motion and this sort of an interaction essentially has very interesting effects on the NMR spectra. Very broadly, these can be classified into either spectral shifts or they can cause nuclear relaxation enhancements. They also, in some cases, can cause splitting of peaks. But for this talk, I'm not going to be talking about that effect. So within the spectral shifts, you can either have contact shifts or you can have pseudo contact shifts. I will explain what these are. And in the nuclear relaxation enhancement segment, you can either have Curie spin relaxation or you can have Solomon relaxation. I will also describe what these mean. So if we think about the spectra themselves, then a nuclear relaxation enhancement essentially means that if you can follow the intensity as a function of time, then if you have a paramagnet in your biomolecule of interest, then residues which are in close proximity to that paramagnet will decay extremely fast compared to the diamagnetic analog. And this will happen whether the source of unpaired electron is isotropic or anisotropic. I will also describe what this means in a minute. The other is the spectral shift. So for example, if you have an anisotropic source of unpaired electron, then in that case, you might see spectral shifts, which can also be then used as interesting. They can be used for refining NMR structures. And in some cases, they can also be used to calculate the anisotropy tensors of the unpaired electron. Okay, so now if we think about contact shifts, I said that the spectral shifts can be of two kinds, contact and pseudo contact. So when do we see contact shifts? Contact shifts are essentially sort of like a scalar coupling sort of a mechanism, just like two nuclei, which are bonded, where if there's a chemical bond between them, then we might see a J coupling like phenomenon between them, which will split the peak into different multiplets depending upon the number of the nuclei. Similarly, the unpaired electron and the nucleus can also be coupled in a scalar coupling type fashion. But this contact shift is only experienced for nuclei which are a few bonds away from the paramagnet. So if the number of bonds which separates the unpaired electron and the paramagnet is, let's say, greater than 4 or 5, then you are not going to see a contact shift for those nuclei. If there is no spin orbit coupling, then there'll essentially be an isotropic sort of a shift. And it is very similar to J coupling, which means that we can use empirical Car plus type relations to use these shifts to obtain dihedral angles between the metal and the nucleus. And if we consider that the paramagnet is indeed isotropic, then this is the mathematical expression which can be used to calculate the contact shift. So here I have shown you three different examples as to what those relations are between the contact shift and the dihedral angle. So for example, if M is the metal ion, and you have defined a dihedral plane, let's say by N between MDC and DCH, then the angle between the dihedral angle essentially is theta in this case. And depending upon what the interaction or the orbitals are between M and D, whether there is a direct sort of an interaction or whether the D orbital is orthogonal to M, then the contact shift will either be proportional to cos squared theta or it will be proportional to sine squared theta. So this is a real example in which your metal center is copper, and so the unpaired electron is in a D orbital, and this is bonded to a sulfur from a cysteine. And so the theta here is essentially the dihedral angle, which is defined by copper, sulfur, carbon, and sulfur, carbon, hydrogen. And it turns out that if we can measure the contact shift for, let's say, carbon or for a proton, then we will find that they actually have a sine square theta dependence. And by fitting our results, if we can get theta, then this can essentially finally even tell us how what the coordination geometry is of such a metal complex. So if you look at a real example where contact shifts have been used to determine the coordination geometry, this is a paramagnetic metalloprotein HIPIP. So this is the A spectrum is that of the reduced protein, and the B spectrum is that of the oxidized protein. The metal center here is an Fe4S4 cluster. And if you look carefully, you will see that in the reduced protein versus in the oxidized protein, some of the peaks have shifted by a great deal, as large as 60-70 ppm. And these straight lines essentially are correlating the peaks between the two spectra. So this is a hyperfine shifted spectrum of this protein. When the iron is either in the reduced state, so in the iron 2 or in the iron 3 state, this shift is not only due to contact but also due to pseudo contact contributions as well. So if by calculating the pseudo contact shift, we can account for the pseudo contact shifts, then we can find out what the contribution from the contact shift is. And by fitting then our data to an equation like this, A sine square theta plus B cos theta plus C, these authors have been able to figure out what the dihedral angles are. So I have shown or marked in cyan which of the dihedral angles they have actually estimated for this example. And this is shown down here. So the theta angles for the four cysteines, which contribute the sulfur in this Fe4S4 cluster, were estimated from the hyperfine shifts of this protein. Okay, so this is the contact coupling part. Now, what about the pseudo contact shifts? Again, just like in normal NMR spectrum, you can have two magnetic moments which can either interact using scalar coupling or by dipolar coupling. So this is essentially the effect that you see when there is dipolar interaction between the unpaired electron and between the nucleus of interest. And the mathematical form of that pseudo contact shift is given here. This might seem a little complicated, but I'll try to explain what this is. So let's say we assume that this is the metal center, this chi Z, chi Y, and chi X, these are actually the components of the magnetic susceptibility tensor of this metal ion. We of course assume that the metal ion behaves like a point dipole, which means that it is essentially, it is not localized all over space. It is pretty much fixed here. With respect to this, the frame of this tensor, if let's say you have a proton at some distance r, which makes an angle of theta and phi, so these are the polar and the azimuthal angles, then if we know chi z, chi x, chi y, and if we know r theta phi, which means if we know the locations of this proton, let's say from a crystal structure, then we should be able to calculate what the pseudo contact shifts are. Okay, so that is one way of calculating the pseudo contact shifts. The other way to do it is to replace chi x, the chi tensor components with the delta chi tensor components, delta chi axial and delta chi radial, which are related to chi z, chi y, and chi x through these relations. Okay, but the inverse problem in which you have experimentally determined a pseudo contact shift and you want to use that pseudo contact shift to find out what r theta phi are. So essentially, if you want to find out what the position of this proton is, that is a little bit more difficult. And for that, you need to expend a little bit more effort than just measuring the pseudo contact shift from a single paramagnetic metal ion of your choice. And if you see here, you'll see that this has an inverse proportionality to R cubed, which means it is a long range effect. In fact, for lanthanides, which show this sort of pseudo contact shifts, you can measure distances up to 40 angstroms. And these distances turn out to be very important structural restraints, which have been used very successfully in many different structure determination efforts for complicated proteins or large proteins. Yes, and so here in this table, what you can see is that for different kinds of paramagnetic metal ions, starting from iron to different kinds of lanthanides, you can see how the delta chi axial and the delta chi radial parameters have changed as a function of time, as a function of the paramagnetic metal ion. So for instance, terbium 3 plus has really large values of delta chi axial and delta chi radial, which tells us that the pseudo contact shift from a protein which has, let's say, a terbium 3 plus in it will be quite large, as compared to something like cerium 3 plus, for example, which only has a delta chi axial of 2.08 and 0.71. We go in a little bit more detail in this. Let's say if we assume that theta is equal to 0, which means that this proton is aligned along the chi z. In that case, in that case, your delta chi radial will be 0. And the only contribution to the pseudo contact shift will be from this delta chi axial term. And these are some calculated pseudo contact shifts at two different distances, 7 and 10 angstroms, for different kinds of paramagnets. So I've shaded in blue some of the ones which are very popularly used in structural biology efforts using paramagnetic NMR. And here again, you can see that as S changes and as delta chi axial changes, the pseudo contact shift at different distances also has very different values. So this can be seen again very clearly. Lanthanum 3 plus is diamagnetic, whereas dysprosium 3 plus is paramagnetic. So if you have somehow been able to label your protein and introduce a diamagnetic metal ion like lanthanum 3 plus, you would get an HSQC spectra, which is shown in black here. And if you then make another sample in which your lanthanum 3 plus is replaced by dysprosium 3 plus, and if you record the spectrum again, you will see that there are large pseudo contact shifts, which are shown in red. And some of them have been actually connected by straight lines to show you the magnitude of the pseudo contact shift. So here too, if you see dysprosium 3 plus is actually one of the lanthanides which is supposed to show you really high pseudo contact shifts. The other thing to note is that pseudo contact shifts can be positive and negative. And just like I said, going from pseudo contact shifts to the location of the nucleus, so the r theta phi values, is not as straightforward as the inverse problem. And the reason for that will be very apparent if you look at this figure. So these are PCS isosurfaces for plus minus 3 ppm, for plus minus 1.5 ppm, and plus minus 0.5 ppm. So the more transparent the PCS isosurface, the smaller it is. And everywhere on that isosurface, the PCS value is exactly the same. So basically, you have many values of r theta phi, which can give you the same pseudo contact shift. So the r theta phi that you get is not going to be unique. All right, so now I'll show you some applications of pseudo contact shifts which have been used as NMR structural restraints. So this is a very old example where the pseudo contact shifts were measured for the protein oxidized horse cytochrome C. And along with your traditional 2278 NOEs, they had also included 241 pseudo contact shift constraints. And when they solved the structure with and without pseudo contact shifts, what they found was that there was a certain region which was very close to the paramagnetic center, whose structure was not really clearly refined when you did not include the pseudo contact shifts. But when you did, you saw that there was actually an alpha helical turn, which was missed when you did not include these pseudo contact shifts. So pseudo contact shifts are very helpful in refinement of NMR structures. This is another example in which the structure of this protein, RAT ERP29C, was determined with the help of 212 pseudo contact shifts. And these were measured by introducing lanthanide ions at four different positions in the protein. So this plot essentially shows you all the different structures that were calculated and their energies. And the energy versus the RMSD between the experimental and the back calculated PCS basically showed you which were the structures which had the lowest energies and also the ones that had the lowest RMSDs. And so if you took five of those structures and if you put them, basically the gray one is the X-ray crystal structure. The red one is the mean structure from, let's say, the 10 or 20 lowest structures that were calculated from here. And the rest are the five lowest energy structures that were calculated when 212 PCSs or pseudo contact shift restraints were introduced into the structure calculation. And what they saw was that the structure that that was calculated using these 212 pseudo contact shifts was very, very similar. I haven't put the mean RMSD here, but you can see that it is all between 0.05 and 0.1 with the X-ray crystal structure that was already solved. And the third example that I have chosen is that of a ligand protein complex. So this is the epsilon 186 protein, which is shown in gray and cyan, which is complex with a small molecule thymidine, which is shown here in yellow and cyan sticks. And the structure of this ligand protein complex was again solved by the inclusion of PCS data from three different lanthanides, dysprosium, terbium, and erbium, and this is the PCS isosurface that was, I think this is for the terbium 3+. And using these, the location of this thymidine small molecule was very nicely resolved to, I think, less than 1 angstrom resolution. So I've shown you 3 different examples where pseudo contact shifts have been successfully used as NMR structural restraints. All right, so now the second kind of effect that the introduction of an unpaired electron has on NMR spectra is that of enhancing the nuclear spin relaxation. So essentially, if you have an unpaired electron, that is the magnetic moment of an unpaired electron and the magnetic moment of a nucleus, which are close by, then if the electron relaxes, then that essentially causes a change in the environment around the nucleus, and it causes the nucleus to relax as well. And if the molecule rotates, then too the interaction between the nucleus and the unpaired electron changes, and that also causes the nucleus to relax. So due to these 2 factors, you can see an enhanced relaxation when there is an unpaired electron which is near a nucleus. Now within these 2 relaxation mechanism, the first one that I will describe to you is the Curie spin relaxation, and this relaxation is due to the coupling between the average magnetic moment of the unpaired electron and the nucleus. It is not affected by how fast the electron is relaxing. It is only affected by the tumbling of the molecule, and it affects both the T1 and the T2, so the transverse and the longitudinal relaxation rates or times, and the mathematical expression is shown here. So this is actually dependent on the field, because there are multiple factors that are at play here. So you have a dependence on the external magnetic field, so B0 square. Then this is also dependent on 1/r⁶. So depending upon how close or how far the nucleus is from the unpaired electron, and also the fact that it affects both T1 and T2, different nuclei at different distances will be affected to different amounts. So if you take, let's say, the spectra, so this is again an example from literature for cobalt 2 substituted human carbonic anhydrase 2, you will see that if you only focus on the minus 20 to the 20 ppm part, so essentially this part, you will see that even though you're going from 90 to 200 to 600, and you would expect that your resolution will be even better, and even for some cases that is true, but there are also some peaks which are extremely broad at high magnetic fields compared to at low magnetic fields. And this is because they are the peaks, or they are the nuclei that have been affected the most by Curie spin relaxation. But this is not something that we use a lot when we are doing paramagnetic NMR. The relaxation phenomena that has been used most widely is really the Solomon relaxation phenomena. So this Solomon relaxation is essentially is a dipolar relaxation phenomena. So just like I said before, if you look at the correlation time, this can be affected by the rotation of the molecule. It can be affected by the electronic relaxation, and it also can be affected by chemical exchange. So all 3 of these processes will determine what the correlation time tau c is. And this correlation time figures in the expression for the enhanced relaxation for the for both the longitudinal and the transverse relaxation rate using these expressions. Just like the Curie spin relaxation, it also has a 1/r⁶ dependence, which means that you can see its effect at nuclei which are much further away than, let's say, if you were measuring NOEs, which can only be measured up to 5 or 6 angstroms. And so therefore, the distances, the electron nucleus distances that we get out from these sort of measurements can also act as very important structural restraints for structure calculations in proteins. So here I'm showing you an example of SRY DNA EDTA complex. So in this example, this gray ribbon diagram is your SRY protein. This is in complex with the DNA, and the DNA has been tagged at a certain position with the EDTA, which is complexed with manganese. So manganese is paramagnetic, but it has an almost isotropic G tensor. So you don't really see any contact or pseudo contact shifts. The only thing you see is a relaxation enhancement. So when this is calcium, in place of manganese, if you have calcium, that is your diamagnetic reference. This is your HSQC spectrum for the protein. When this is replaced with manganese, you see that many of the peaks have either broadened beyond detection, or they have become very broad and therefore much less intense if you compare them with the calcium chelated or the diamagnetic control. So in particular, if you look at this peak, the M30 peak, you will see that in the calcium sample, this decays at a certain rate, whereas in the manganese sample, because it is in close proximity to the manganese center, it undergoes, it essentially has enhanced relaxation. This is the T2, and therefore it decays really fast. And this is the reason why it has, it is less intense in the manganese sample as compared to the calcium sample. And here you see that all the residues that are in close proximity to this manganese center, if they measure the enhanced T2s or R2s, they found that it was about greater than 15 second inverse. So this was a very sure way to test that this is the part that comes in close proximity to the DNA here. Okay. So if we compare between the Solomon and the Kuri relaxation enhanced R2 rates, we can see that for different metal centers in different coordination geometries, the contributions from the Curie and the Solomon rates are very different. So I'll start with nickel in 4 coordination. This has a spin of half and a picosecond relaxation time. And what we find is that at 5 angstroms versus 10 angstroms, both the Curie and the dipolar R2 rates are quite small. And this is very similar to what you would also observe at a higher magnetic field of 900 megahertz. Whereas for copper, which is a spin 1/2, this relaxes in the nanosecond time scale. It has a significantly large contribution to the from the Solomon mechanism, that is the dipolar mechanism, but a very small contribution of only 20 from the Curie mechanism at both the magnetic fields of 500 and 900. And if you go from, let's say, 5 to 10 angstroms, you find that the distance dependence is quite clearly seen. So you have, it has almost gone down. The dipolar contribution to R2 has almost gone down by 60 times. So it's from 3000 to 50. And then if you compare, let's say, with gadolinium, which is a lanthanide and one that is very commonly used, which has a spin of 7/2, also relaxes somewhere in the nanosecond time scale, you have a huge dipolar contribution compared to, let's say, copper or nickel. Also a substantial contribution from the Curie spin relaxation. And this too has, and you see this even at 10 angstroms, at distances that are 10 angstroms away from this gadolinium 3+ center. And if we look at some representative applications of PREs in solution NMR, I have chosen, these are only representative, there are many, many more interesting examples. So the first one is where I told you that both the T1 and the T2 are affected by the introduction of a paramagnet. So the paramagnet here is nickel in a DOTA type complex. This paramagnet is such that it affects T1 much more than it affects T2. So in this paper, what they did was they took a sample of Sumo, which is a protein, and they titrated it with varying concentrations of this DOTA complex of nickel. and they measured the T1 and T2 residue wise. And what they found was that T1 was affected very significantly. So it goes from, let's say, from black to red to blue to green, but T2 was not really affected much. So this was quite nice because it would mean that you didn't have to wait so much in between two scans. So your relaxation delay could have been made really fast, which would lead to a significant sensitivity enhancement, which is shown here if you compare between those two spectra. And there will not be a large broadening of the spectrum as well due to the paramagnetic effect because the T2s are not affected significantly. The second example is from this paper. So here they have basically compared the structure of the SRY DNA complex by including or excluding PREs from three sites. So these PREs were measured from this protein, which was artificially derivatized with an EDTA tag, which was then complexed with manganese. So if you don't include PRE or if you don't include, let's say, residual dipolar couplings, you'll see something like this, which is a mess. You don't know what the structure is. If you do include PRE but don't include RTC, you do a much better job. And this is far better than the structure that you would get if you only solve it using RDCs but no PREs. And of course, the best structure is when you have both the PRE and the RTC. And the third example is where PREs were used to detect transiently populated intermediate states, which are typically, let's say, populated to sometimes less than 1%. So what they found was they derivatized the DNA. Again, this is the same SRY DNA complex. They derivatized the DNA at four different sites, which is shown in red here. And they collected the PREs for each of those samples, the results of which can be shown here at two different concentrations of sodium chloride. And they found that the calculated and the observed T2 PREs, or the relaxation enhancement in the R2s, was not very significant. I mean, they matched really well at 20 millimolar, but there was a very large discrepancy at 160 millimolar, which told them that you could not use just one structure to calculate the PREs. You had to use multiple ones. And when they did so, they actually found that there are several states or several conformations of this protein, which engages with the DNA at different points. And if you include these conformations in your structure calculations, then you could get a very good agreement between the calculated and the observed values. And to end my talk, I will go back to what I have started off with, which is how do we introduce paramagnetic species into diamagnetic proteins if we want to do paramagnetic NMR? So the most commonly used way is essentially to use this MTSL derivative, which can be easily reacted with exposed cysteines in your protein. So this is the nitroxide tag. But people have designed many different tags, which are mostly thiol reactive. So you could have thiol reactive EDTA based tags, cyclin or DOTA based tags, or IDA or NTA based tags. And these can very nicely complex with different transition metal ions at different affinities. The other way of doing it is to use amino acid sequences which have some affinity to different metal ions. So for example, these are four different amino acid sequences which have been shown to bind lanthanides. This is a motif. This is a X1, X2 histidine motif, which is attached to the N-terminal of protein. So this is the Atkun motif, and this is known to complex nickel and copper. And lastly, you could also genetically encode either spin labels or metal chelating amino acids into the protein of interest. This is not very, very popular, but it has been used. So even if you do not have a naturally occurring paramagnetic metalloprotein, you can essentially take any protein of your choice and paramagnetically label it with any of the methods available to use to you, and then use them to measure either contact pseudo-contact shifts or paramagnetic relaxation-based NMR restraints, and then use them for the study of structure and dynamics of the protein of your choice. So with that, I would like to end my talk. And thank you all for your attention.
Thank you, ma'am. That was one quite informative talk. We have some questions lined up for you. First question, why do you prefer NMR over EPR spectroscopy for studying paramagnetic species?
Because we're looking at the N50, the nucleus, right? EPR usually looks at the unpaired electron.
Okay. Next question. How can NMR-based techniques be used for structural elucidation and identification of microbial pigments and other bioactive metabolites?
Do you mean paramagnetic NMR or in general NMR methods?
I think so. They mean in general NMR methods. They haven't mentioned any paramagnetic.
I don't know about metabolites, but all I know is that it is used quite commonly. People do use NMR to look at metabolites and small molecules.
Okay. Last question. What are the advantages of determining the structure of a protein using only PCS when compared to the conventional method where NOE distances are used?
So typically for NOEs, like I said, you will only get short range distances. So you have to collect NOEs in thousands to get information about all parts of the protein. So your NOEs will die off, you know, when you've crossed a 6 angstrom limit. But using PCS or using PREs, you can measure distances which are all the way up to 20, 25, 40 angstroms. And so they serve as, and even with as few as, let's say, 200 pseudo contact shifts or 200 PREs, people have been able to solve structures. So the number of restraints that one would need, of course, you might need to make more samples as compared to when you're only collecting NOEs. But these long range distance restraints are not available when you use your conventional NMR methods.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am, for answering our questions. We have an upcoming webinar next week on LC QTOF technologies and its applications metabolics. Registrations are open and links are given on our website. Thank you so much, Professor Ishita, for giving us your valuable time and delivering us the talk. A special thanks to Professor Anil Kotantriyar for initiating the webinar series on the instruments housed at SAIF IIT Bombay. Thank you, Dr. Nutan Agadi, for all their kind support. I thank our IT team, Mrs. Nidhi Goyal and Jagdeep Singh, for their continuous technical support. Thank you all the participants for making this event successful. Stay safe and stay healthy. Thank you. Have a nice day.